you know, it's still 3 million people. This is 65,000. So it's a big difference. But we have a lot more competition there. But I do have partners now. I didn't have partners before, which brings a whole new level of headaches, but it's also a bonus in that I can share some of the responsibilities of not just being the only rainmaker. So maintaining solid financial statements, accrual accounting base, everybody knows what that is. Separating your personal from your business, using leverage optimally and responsibly. So a rule of thumb on debt, I'll just real quickly on this and then we'll be done. Short-term debt, such as credit card debt or short-term loans from other shareholders, whatever it is, should always result in a current ratio of no more than industry norm. So if your current ratio, which is your current assets divided by your current liabilities, is 1.5 to 2, which it is in a lot of places, a lot of industries, you don't want to break too far outside of that by increasing your short-term debt. Also, in terms of long-term debt, your increase in sales due to new long-term debt should double the amount of new borrowings. So you're going to have to project, if you borrow $100,000 to go out and buy a new piece of equipment or to hire another person or to expand into a larger space, you should project $200,000 increase in sales from that, double the amount of the new borrowings. And that's a good rule of thumb to go by if you're trying to manage your leverage. And I'll give you a quick example of how this works. So let's start with a company that has $1 million in sales. And up down here, if you look down here, right now they've got long-term debt at 35%, which equals 122.5, and they've got equity of 65%, which equals 227.5. They got 70% cost of goods sold, 25% operating expenses, that gives them an EBIT of 50,000 or 5%, and they're paying interest at the 12% interest rate on this money equals $15,000 in interest, and they got a net income of 35,000 or 3.5%. And down here, their return on assets is 10% because their net income is 35,000 and their total assets is 350,000. So they've got a 10% return on assets. Well, let's say they want to borrow another $100,000 and hopefully get another 200,000 in sales. So the sales go up from 1 million to 1.2 million. They still have 70% cost of sales. Their operating margin is going to grow because their operating expenses are going to go down somewhat because of the economies of scale. Some expenses are variable and some are fixed. So that's going to come down from 25% to 21%, so you get a little bit better EBITDA margin. And then your interest rate, you're still paying 12% interest, and you're paying it on an additional $100,000 in debt, so now your debt is $222,500 instead of $122,500. There's your interest, it's 27.5. Now, if you look at your net income is 82,755, and it's a return on assets of 6.9%, which is better. Your return on debt is 37%, which is better, and your return on equity is 36.4%, which is better than it was. You can't see it, but it was 15-something down at the bottom. So this is an example of how additional borrowing, when they can increase the sales by double the amount of the new borrowings, can result in a better operating results. And lastly, there's the thing on succession planning. Sometimes the only exit plan is your employees. That may be the only buyer of your company. Shares can be sold through incentive compensation earmarked towards paying debt for shares. So for example, you can give them bigger bonuses or bonus compensation that they can use to buy out your shares. Businesses are typically sold either an asset sale or a share sale. We talked about that already, and you can do it a couple different ways. You can do a term sale, where the buyer places a down payment of say between 10 and 25% and agrees to purchase the rest over a couple of years, and then they receive you know, a small amount of the shares while the seller retains the others. And each year, the buyer uses his share of distributions to pay for additional shares. And the seller stays on as a salary for that period of time as a consultant to assist in the transition, particularly if there's personal goodwill involved. Another way of doing it is seller financing. So if the seller can finance all or a portion of the sale, he can take a charge over the shares. We can always get them back if he's not paid. Distributions are used to pay down the note or the debt. You can charge an interest rate. Usually it's fairly nominal. And again, the seller can stay on as a consultant to assist in the transition to the new buyer. And then also, too, you have buy-sell agreements between partners, which are usually documents that say, this is how we're going to value the shares. If you want to buy more, or I want to buy more, we're going to sell between us. Over time, you're going to buy me out, and you don't know how much you're going to buy me out yet. We're going to have this buy-sell agreement where you're going to pay, this is how we're going to value it. We're going to value it on a multiple basis or whatever, based on the earnings for that particular year. And that's set forth in this agreement. There's not going to be any argument over it. And that's how that's done. And buy-sell agreements are another reason why people like us come in and value these companies to set up the basis for how these buy-sell agreements work. That is it. If you guys want to, you know, you can obviously take my card, my email address, my phone number. Let me know if you have any questions. Email me if you want a copy of the slides. I'll be happy to send them over to you. And mostly I would just say, you know, like I tell most people, don't try this at home. it's not easy as a lot of people think. But, you know, this gives you an idea of kind of what we do and how we get started with it. It typically is a complex exercise, even for the smallest of companies. That's kind of the basis of business valuation. And unless anybody have any final questions before we wrap it up?
So, yes, sir. So what is your role? Are you often sort of brought in between, like a buyer and a seller, to sort of come up with a reasonable valuation, or somebody wants to stick their thing on the market, they want to come up with a reasonable before they add their 10% on top of whatever you're going to come up with, whatever they're big enough.
It's been both. Just examples of some of the ones I did recently. One was a single owner company who thinking about selling his business and kind of wants just to know what to ask for it. He thinks he might have a buyer in mind. And I was acting specifically for him, not for the other party. Another one was a shareholder wanting to buy out other shareholders, and so both of them agreed to engage a valuation. And then there's been a litigation where I'm acting for one party because the other party is aggrieved and they want to sell out, they want out, but they don't want to sell too cheaply, and so there's a disagreement over what the company's worth. So there's all those different things, and then we do some for financial reporting too.
Do you also act as a broker?
No. It's a different. There are business valuers who act as brokers. I mean, not here in Cayman, but they typically do it on a more of a cowboy basis, in that they're not. So we're our modus operandi is we're an unbiased third party, like, and we have to operate within certain valuation standards that say I'm not allowed to be swayed by your opinion. Like, you can talk up your business or whatever it is I'm valuing as much as you want to. I'm going to apply my objective opinion to that, and that's what I'm going to do. And but business brokers can basically be advocates, and they oftentimes are not acting within a specific business valuation standards, and they're providing a document that's a bit more like a brochure, like, here's what the business is worth and why, but it's really more of a marketing document that you would hand out to somebody. And that's a different kind of process. Everything, in my opinion, kind of be one or the other, because if you're putting yourself out there as being professionally qualified, business appraiser, business value, or whatever, we're acting as unbiased third parties within a certain set of standards, and our designations, our qualifications mean that we have to abide by a code of conduct and all that. So it's different.
So are you the mean, are you like, are there other people like you in Cayman, or are you like the, like if someone wanted to find like a valuation of a business to purchase or to sell, et cetera, then, I mean, are there like half a dozen people in Cayman that you could go to that ready to do that, or who would, or are you?
There's, so within the public accounting space, the big firms will pass these on to their counterparts, typically the US or Canada or whatever.
Okay.
Then you have, like she's mentioning, she's with Duff and Phelps, so they're a huge valuation firm, but they don't do valuation here in Cayman. They do liquidation, and liquidation of funds is the big thing here, obviously.
Right.
So you have a lot of accounting firms who do liquidations here that will say they do valuations, but they don't really specialize in it. You know, they specialize either on the accounting side or the liquidation side, insolvency practitioners, all of that. They're all here, but you know, our firm is specifically valuation, and in terms of direct competitors, that's, you know, and we operate mostly for companies that are operating here. Like, we're not doing a lot of fund work and that kind of thing. So we're doing operating companies and business interests, partial interests, and real estate and that kind of thing. So I would say for that, the space that we're in, we're fairly weak.
Well, the difference between you and our company, because we're an exempt company, while we operate here, but we can't liquidate his business because it's
mm-hmm.
a local business.
Mm-hmm.
So he has the benefit over us, where
mm-hmm.
he can deal with you while we can't.
Right.
That's because of the type of license that our company has.
Mm-hmm.
So now we're talking about trading business licenses.
Okay, so I think she's handing out the valuation forms, and again, I appreciate all of you coming, and hope you've enjoyed it, and let me know if you have any questions or anything, and I'm happy to help.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.